It's the third round with this week's guests, Allegheny County Councilwomen Hallam and Bennett. Segments including Naked Politics, PA, Big Time Political Wrestling, and so, these pandemics. But now, here's Dito. Welcome to Naked Politics, Pennsylvania, with your host, Pittsburgh City Papers, Ryan Dito, and our special political guest today, Allegheny County Councilwoman Liv Bennett. Welcome, and take it away, Ryan.
Hey, everyone. We're back with another edition of our great new podcast about politics and drinking and whatever else we want to talk about, as long as it's about Pennsylvania and Allegheny County and everything else. I got my Straub here, local Western PA, probably one of the best ones, I think. I'm happy to be here. Liv, welcome.
Thanks so much, and thanks for having me. I'm also happy to be here. I don't have any Straub on hand, but kudos to you.
It's funny, they have cans now, and they are actually famous for having these like recyclable bottles. Which they were kind of pioneering before it was cool to recycle. So they're definitely the, you know, OGs here in Western PA. But anyway, let's talk about politics. That's why we're here. So today we're going to be talking about naked ballots. This is a naked Pennsylvania politics edition. And you obviously know probably more than anybody about naked ballots. So why don't you kind of let us know what they are and how you've been trying to inform people about them.
All right, so naked ballots are ballots that are not placed in the secrecy envelope prior to being placed in the declaration envelope before being either mailed or dropped to your local election office to submit your vote. So that is the reason why the seriousness of that is because in the primary, that was not a factor, right. and they were not discounting secrecy or ballots that were not in the secrecy envelope. So every vote was counted, whether or not it was in the secrecy envelope or not. That has changed with the general election. So it could be confusing for folks, especially since just one election ago, it was permissible not to put it in the secrecy ballot envelope. So it was forecasted about 100,000 votes would be lost due to not being placed in the secrecy ballot secrecy envelope. So we really wanted to get the message out there about what it meant, you know, when folks, because the term naked ballots kind of went went viral. I saw it on the news. I saw it online. I saw it everywhere. So we figured we would just have fun with it and also educate at the same time. So we literally got naked and to try to educate to submit your ballot correctly so that it would be counted. So as you see, Councilwoman Bethany Hallam, who is the actual person who was the mastermind behind this idea, newly elected, she's state rep elect at this moment, right. Emily Kincaid, who just won, and she's my state rep.
That's
and
right.
Then it's me in the middle, obviously. So as you see, we took it all off, and Rep Emily has the ballot in front of her. I have the secrecy envelope in front of me, and right. Bethany has the declaration envelope. And on the bottom, you see very clear steps on how to make sure you're submitting your vote correctly. So you fill out your ballot, you then place it in the secrecy envelope and seal that envelope, and then you fill out your declaration envelope and place everything in your declaration envelope and seal that. And that is how you submit your ballot.
And that's it.
And that is it.
And what's so great about your guys' campaign is that you're drawing attention to this. And, you know, Bethany's tweet went viral when she tweeted it out. And then she's got a ton of coverage. She's got national news coverage. You all got local and national news coverage for this. And what's so great about it is that it draws your eye, obviously, because you guys are bearing it all. And but also it just reminds people just how simple it is. And you're right, it wasn't there in the primary, so it wasn't a concern. The Supreme Court ruled that they had to be in the secrecy envelope, so that's what it has to be. But there's also no real need to panic, because this is a very simple thing, right? It's just put it in an envelope. You just got to put it in that. You're right there. You're the secrecy envelope.
I'm the secrecy envelope. So yeah, it was just really, you know, we really wanted to figure out how to be creative and get the message out there. I mean, love it, hate it, you know, wanting us to, you know, be scolded and wear the Scarlet A, whatever your stance is.
There were a few conservatives who for some reason thought this was in bad faith, but honestly they probably think it's in bad taste because they don't want people to vote by mail, because they Democrats vote by mail more than Republicans do. So they
now we do. I mean, back in the state of Arizona, for example, which was very red at one time, 70% of Arizona votes by mail. Our own president votes by mail and has voted by mail for quite a long time. So it's just very hypocritical to me that these folks are like, oh, voting by mail. Meanwhile, they've voted by mail for quite a while in many elections.
So, all of them, all the time.
Exactly. Yeah. So the selective outrage is quite entertaining at times. Just like, you know, when they reached out to us about this, it's like, if you took your son, daughter to a pool, they've seen is at least this much skin. So right. I'm gonna need y'all to really, you know, check your hypocrisy.
Totally.
So we
and
did.
A lot of those pools will reopen too, especially in the suburbs and stuff like that, where there might be more Republicans. They had their pools, not us in the city. We didn't have our pools, you know?
Exactly. So they were standing out with rifles, making sure they had their pools. So anyway, we did a second round because, you know, when we feel like we got something good, we're going to double down.
Absolutely.
We're going to triple down and quadruple down. So.
Yeah, why don't you explain what we're seeing here with all of our...
Yes. So our second round here, going left from right, is our mayor of Duquesne, Nikki Nesby, our state rep, Sarah Annamorato, and also a newly elected Aetna council person, Jessica Simler. So that's our second round. We're working on a third. Trust us, we are. We've gotten some men who have they haven't done the professional like ones we've done, but like the brick, you always know it's ours because the brick background.
Right.
But they kind of jumped in, like put the secrecy envelope over their chest and have posted on their own as well. So it's really gaining traction, and I think it's just a fun way. I mean, politics is so serious all the time. It's always like we're arguing we're disagreeing and this person is trash and that person is this and that. Like, let's have some fun.
Right.
you gave us a term, naked ballot, and you didn't expect us to run with it. So it's just keeping it light, but also educating at the same time and really pushing out the message on, you know, what a naked ballot is, because that's also what happens a lot of times. There's also a lot of lingo that's used in politics that everyday Americans might not even understand. They're like, the heck is a naked ballot? So there you go.
There it is. And that's all it is too. And that's what everyone needs to remember, is that it literally is just almost a blank ballot that just says official election ballot. That's it. It's just a way to keep your ballot secret for when the election, you know, workers are counting it. That's like, that's the only reason it's there. And so it's real simple. And there are instructions that come with the thing too. Just read the instructions. It's not that hard. Like, and so it's such a good way to just remind people. And I'm so glad you guys are keep doing more rounds and everything like that. It's just so that they know every week. And so we're talking about education of voting. Why don't we talk about some other stuff too that is important for Allegheny County voters in terms of how what other methods? So, you know, this is the method they have to do with the secrecy envelope, but you don't have to necessarily turn in your ballot in your mailbox, right? What are some other methods that people in Allegheny County can, you know, vote by mail?
So this election cycle, I mean, we have more options than ever before. And I'm super excited about that because that's really been something we've been fighting for, making voting more accessible and really allowing folks to engage in the process. And how do you get folks to engage? You make it more accessible. So instead of really concentrating on voter day, November 3rd, we're really making it a voter season. This is voter season. So, you know, we have voter registration going on right now. Voter registration ends on October 19th. So that's a big push right now. You can register to vote at what are upcoming in our county at the satellite locations. Yep. We're having satellite locations opening starting to open October 10th, and we'll open every single weekend throughout the county.
So that way people don't have to come all the way downtown.
Exactly. So people
South Hills.
Yes. And the county downtown office will be opened every single one of these weekends too. So you can, if you'd like to go downtown,
right, and you live downtown
there during the week, whatever, you can go down there. But we also will have, you know, North Park Ice Skating Ring, South Park Ice Skating Ring, Carnegie DPW Garage Number 2, CCAC Homewood, Allegheny CCAC, CCAC South, Boyce Park Ski Lodge, Shop and Save in the Hill District. So all these locations will be available to folks every weekend throughout the county so that they don't have to figure out how to make their way downtown. These places you can go, you can apply for your mail-in ballot, actually receive your mail-in ballot, vote your mail-in ballot, and drop your mail-in ballot and be done right there that day.
You can do it all right there. It's basically
all right there. Now, while you can register to vote at these locations, you will not be able to register to vote and then cast a ballot because the system is not sophisticated enough that we can actually see the eligibility remote. So anybody who does a registration, those will go back downtown, then be processed downtown and go through that process. And then you would have to do a two-step process there. Okay. But if you're registered to vote, one-stop shop. You get it, you apply, you get it, you vote it, you drop it.
And also people can also register to vote very easily online. Well.
Absolutely. Votes PA. I like to call it Votes Spa. Go to the Votes Spa and visit and kick your feet up and register.
Well, you're naked, right? You might as well get in the spa, right?
Right. Like you get that straw, or like me, if you don't drink Shirley Temple, like, and you can do almost everything on Votes Spa. You can register to vote. You can apply for your mail-in ballot. You could check your voter registration. You could check your polling place. Like almost anything that you would ever ask yourself about voting, you can go to Vote Spa and figure that out. If you're looking for things that kind of research who's on your ballot, places like Votes 411, good place to do something like that. So there's places to go to educate yourself on who's on your ballot, if on your registration status. All of these things have been, there's a lot of online resources to allow us to do those types of explorations and not even leave our homes. Right. One other thing I would add is that if you did apply for your mail-in ballot and you do receive it, like I received mine today, and you don't trust to put it in the mail, you can take it to one of these satellite locations or downtown to your county office building, to the election office, and actually physically drop your ballot there if you don't trust putting it in the mail. So, like I said, we are trying to really push out every single option this election cycle because, one, we know we're in a pandemic, but two, this is a very important election, and anybody who wants to vote, we want to make sure they have the opportunity, access, and availability to do so.
Absolutely. Well, okay, so the one thing, the one last thing I want to, you know, talk about with this is, what happens if you get your ballot and then you decide you want to vote in person at your polling place? Can people do that?
They can. So what they really are suggesting is that you take that ballot to the polling place with you so that they can witness it being destroyed. But if you don't, and I've had this question because I've been doing voter registration. Somebody came and asked me very recently, well, how do we know, or what's keeping people from, voting twice?
Right.
And so I will say every single voter has a unique identification, kind of like a QR code or a SQ.
Yeah. Like a barcode.
Right, it's something that a barcode that is unique to you as a voter. So every single one of us has a very unique barcode. And once that is scanned and identified as casting a vote, anything that comes in beyond that will be rejected. Right. So there are the technology is advanced enough that we are able to do that to avoid from getting duplicate votes. So if you do decide that you don't want to vote by your mail-in ballot and want to vote in person, one, take your mail-in ballot to the polling place with you so that they can see you haven't voted it. If you didn't, that's fine. They will let you vote. They may give you a provisional ballot, but once that is, you know, goes downtown and has been determined that you haven't voted, it will be counted. And if you don't take your ballot to the poll to turn it in that way, please destroy it. And by destroy, I mean shred, rip. Just make sure that you're not just crumbling and so somebody else can
pick it up.
Yeah. So we're not. Of course. I mean, me personally, I'm advocating for vote by mail just because I think that there's a population that is going to vote and really don't want to vote by mail. They're going to vote in person regardless. But I feel like there's a population that is comfortable with voting by mail. So my kind of message is, if you're comfortable voting by mail, please do so, to leave open for those that we know that will not vote by mail so that we can make sure that they're we're not sending droves of people to the poll. Right. We're still able to keep social distancing and not having lines and things like that. So, again, though, however you decide to vote, just please vote.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's so many different ways now, and polling places that they consolidated in the primary, they switched that back.
Yes.
So we have almost all of our polling places back open again. So, you know, one of the great things about being in Pennsylvania, it's a bad thing in terms of general fractured government, but also it's a good thing in terms of voting, because there's so many polling places that lines aren't always an issue. And hopefully if enough people vote by mail and those people who aren't comfortable decide to vote, there won't be a huge line issue. But, hopefully that won't work out that way, but it's really easy. I mean, it's so easy.
It's super easy, super, super easy. Like, it couldn't be any easier.
Councilwoman, one important question as we're finishing up, if I may.
You may.
As a humble announcer. You're doing a third series of these naked ballot informational posters, and it features men. Are these men super sexy?
Ooh, well, you know, sexy is in the eye of the beholder.
Amen to that.
So, in their eyes, in their wife's eyes, and whoever, they're sexy to somebody, I'm sure. I, in all honesty, I'm not sure who the men are yet, because we have a few rounds of men. My husband's supposed to be doing one. So okay. I would say he's sexy.
Woof.
I'm excited to see. It's like a little like Easter egg, a little surprise. We don't even know.
It is. It's like, who's going to pop up next with one of these? Who's going to do it next? Who are we going to see? Bearing it all for democracy. Like, you know, we're save democracy by any means necessary.
Right. And just remember to just put your ballot in the little official election ballot secrecy envelope. That's it. It's easy. It's easy peasy. It is.
And I love, and the one thing I do love about voting from home is I remember, like, you know, before I was Liv Bennett, the county councilor, you know, I was Liv Bennett, the you know, just regular old civilian. And right. Liv Bennett didn't always know who might have been on her ballot. So we're standing at the, you know, ballot box and I'm like, oh, that's a cute name. Like, right. And I'm being super real. Like, or that person's from my neighborhood. Okay. Right. Don't know anything about them. Right. I don't know. I could be voting in the next freaking Jeffrey Dahmer for all I know. So like, I really appreciate the fact that now, you know, we could take a beat. We can look at our ballot, really examine it, look who's on it, go look them up.
Right.
Don't look what their platform is.
That's
look
such a good
what thing. They stand for, and right. actually be educated and informed when we cast our vote. How much better can our democracy be when we actually are, you know, standing at the ballot box just guessing at it and actually right. are informing ourselves with who we're voting for and making sure that they're aligning as closely to us as possible.
Right. And you know, something to remember in every election and even this election is that it's not just between President Trump and Joe Biden. There are a lot of down ballot races. There's attorney general, there's state treasurer, there's auditor general, there's state house, there's state senate. There's a ballot initiative in Pittsburgh that you might want to look up, you know, before you vote. It's about policing. It's an important one. I'm going to be writing about it for our election guide coming up.
Oh, and, great.
Yeah, and so, yeah, that's totally a good point. It's like, if you're a little nervous about exactly who's on the ballot, vote by mail, because then you can look it up. You can go to the office, you know, you can go to those satellite offices too and just scroll through your phone a little bit, Google these people before you decide to cast your vote. Like, that's like such a really good point. And it's real easy to educate yourself with the 21st century. It's just Google it. Go to City Paper. We write about these people all the time.
Yeah, I want to say City Paper probably had the best guide that I saw when I was running, like, that was very accurate between my opponent. I was like, wow, somebody finally got it. Okay.
I do,
like, look at those. They are informative and a really good one, like City Paper or League of Women Voters. They really try to find the differences for you so that you're not looking at them like, oh, well, what's the difference? They look the same to me. They really do try to dig and be like, okay, where do they, you know, they're both Democrats, especially for the primary. It's very important to do that because you're running people within the same party.
Right.
So, you know, it really does help when you're looking at these folks and seeing what their differences are. Like if they're pro-police or, I won't say anti-police, but I'll say police reform, or if they're, you know, for, you know, just things like if they're not for cash, no cash bail. I mean, just all these things that are coming up right now, if they're not for defunding or they are for defund. I mean, you can go and look. You can look. It's not a secret, people. We all have to come out with platforms and we all have to run on one. So it has to be put out there somewhere. So it's not a secret what these folks are running on and what they believe in. It's just, are you dedicated enough and want to be informed enough to go seek out what it is that their platforms are and what they're going to stand for when they actually take their office.
Right. And our election guide, City Paper election guide is coming out on, I'm trying to remember. I believe we're going to put it out on the 21st. So this is a little different now with all the early voting. Is like, we've actually moved it up a little bit too. We might have to start moving it up even more into the future. But at the same time, I want those people who are going to the polls to also not have to go back 3 weeks issues. It's complicated, but I'm excited for all this. And I also want to mention too that one of our spouses of our staff, also did one of these naked ballot fun little things too on his Twitter account. So it's spreading, you know.
It's definitely spreading, and so yeah, I appreciate all the work you're doing. Yeah, you guys might need to move it up because if there wasn't that Green Party challenge,
right,
people would have been eligible to vote. The ballots would have been ready by September 14th.
Right, so, 50 days before.
Yeah. So y'all might want to think about moving it up closer now that we're talking about election season as opposed to election day.
Right. Yeah, and this is the adjustments that we just make through democracy and voting. Well, anyway, I think that's all the time we have. So, humble announcer, you wanna take us out?
I will take you out. I will take you out. Thank you, Councilwoman Liv Bennett, for your kind time, good thought, and for letting it all hang out for democracy. And Ryan Dito, as always, thank you for your hosting of Naked Politics, Pennsylvania. Today's third round is brought to you by beer. Beer's delicious, and you should have one. Beer, it's what brings you the third round.
Hey, everyone. I'm Ryan Dito. I'm the news editor with the Pittsburgh City Paper. I'm here with Allegheny County Councilor Liv Bennett, and we're just going to talk about naked ballots real quick. And Liv, why don't you tell us why you're naked and what naked ballots are?
So, yes, thanks, Ryan, for asking. I'm naked because I don't want y'all to have your ballot naked. I need you to dress your ballot. So what that means is when you fill out your ballot, you get, when you receive your ballot, there are two envelopes with the ballot. So you fill out your ballot, then you just put it into your first envelope, which is the secrecy envelope, which is the one that's over my chest. And it says the official election ballot. So you put your ballot into that envelope, seal that envelope, and then you then put both of those, your ballot, which is in your secrecy envelope, into your declaration envelope, which is what Bethany has, and you seal that envelope, fill it out, and that is how you turn in your ballot. So
right. And sign it too, right?
Yes, you sign it and you date it. There's some things that it'll ask you for on there, and you just fill that out and you turn that in. So dressing your ballot literally means taking your ballot and putting it into the secrecy envelope, and that is dressing your ballot. And then you just put that in the declaration envelope, which is your mailing ballot, which is your mailing envelope, and there you go.
And that's pretty much all the naked ballot controversy is dressing your ballot in the envelope and then putting it in the other, you know, bigger declaration envelope and mailing it off, right?
Absolutely. And you have now dressed your ballot.
Great. Thanks, guys.
Today's segment of Big Time Political Wrestling is brought to you by beer. Beer, we really do love you this much. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Big Time Political Wrestling. Today's topic, old school versus new school in professional wrestling and professional politics. Today, we're going to take you back to 1985 in our prior century. To the prison in Philadelphia, our much just reviled nemesis across state. But today we're there because so is Rowdy Roddy Piper, Cowboy Bob Orton, Paul Mr. Wonderful Orndorff, and Pittsburgh's hero and wrestling's living legend, actually late living legend, Bruno Sammartino. Bruno came out of retirement, made a big splash for a little while till he got pissed off at professional wrestling and left, and had a long feud and rivalry with Roddy Piper. He was viciously mocked for being old, which I think as an old person is unfair. But in this case, it worked really well as a professional wrestling shtick. So let's zoom into the prism, listen a little bit on the interviews, and then we'll take a minute to talk about politics with our special guest today, journalist and professional pundit, Pittsburgh City Paper's Ryan Dito.
Hello, everyone.
And the Honorable Allegheny County Councilwoman Bethany Hallam.
Hello.
And they being youngish, know a lot about the new school. And Bethany, I believe, has a personal stake in the new school, old school feud. Or everybody's working together now. All right, on to the prism in Philadelphia. Here we go.
Match you'll be telling your grandchildren about. Now, we interviewed Bruno Sammartino, and he was talking about how age didn't matter and how he does not like Rowdy Roddy Piper. Want to talk about that, Ace?
Whoop-dee-doo. It's not that he doesn't like Roddy Piper. He's jealous. It's hard for an old man to sit back and watch the young new tiger lion come in and take his slot. You know, Bruno Sammartino is senile. He's an old man. He doesn't understand. Training techniques have changed. Athletes are better. They're tougher. They're stronger than they ever have been before. He lays a lot of names on you that are so old, most of the people who would have remembered him have already died, and comes out here trying to prove something to somebody. Sammartino, just admit it. You're passé. This is wrestling's new legend. I'm his bodyguard and make sure he does exactly what he wants to do.
I love my bodyguard. So he's running 8 miles a day. That's because he's afraid of his wife. You told me he lost 40 pounds. That's from emphysema and psoriasis and problems going to the body. That's why you lost 40 pounds. It wasn't to fight me you lost 40 pounds. What you did is you got yourself in this big swell where all these people all in wheelchairs and canes and all the guys, Bruno, and they're falling over and people are picking them up and husking them up. It ain't my fault that your hair's leaving you. That could be something to do with a 40 pounds. Had nothing to do with me. It ain't my fault that at nighttime you go straight to bed and straight to sleep. That has nothing to do with me. You want to come and fight a lion? You want to come and fight a tiger? Help yourself, and I know you're one of my greatest fans.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Roddy Piper, in my estimation, the greatest professional wrestling interview of all time. So that kind of sets the stage, and you know, he had some very nasty things to say about wrestling's living legend.
I mean, kind of sounds like Bethany, honestly. I mean,
So I hope we could talk a little bit about old school, new school while they roll the match here at the Spectrum in Philadelphia.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, what's so funny is that, you know, Bethany, when she won her race, actually defeated a former professional wrestler who had served on county council for, I think, like 15 years or something along that estimation. And it was kind of like the culmination of, maybe not culmination, but really the legitimacy of Pittsburgh Democratic politics of kind of like a new school coming in, like taking, you know, really taking shots, I guess, at like the old school. I don't know, right? You know, Bethany, what'd you say?
Oh yeah, I mean, that's exactly what it came to. I mean, there was a point in the race where my opponent even called himself the progressive champion, you know? And so it really was just, you know, to outsiders, it was this person, newcomer to politics, you know, 28 years old. And then it was this former professional wrestler who literally was like, he's a legend in the professional wrestling world, you know? And so, and then he was, you know, a half of a century older than me, had served on council for 20 years, literally since council existed.
Right.
He was there. And then when I came in, I mean, at first a lot of people just laughed at me because they were like, do you know who you're going up against? Like, right. he is a legend. And I, right, you know, had to respect that throughout the campaign and make sure that like it never crossed the line of like, hey, I'm gonna be a better council person than you, but like no disrespect to you as a person ever.
We should say too that this is a, you know, former county councilor John DeFazio, who was known as Jumpin' Johnny as a pro wrestler. And right, as Bethany says, he was on council since the formation of council, which was started like 20 years ago with help of the current executive, Rich Fitzgerald. And and it you know, her race really was I guess kind of shocking, because it was like, I think it was the first time that it was like countywide, basically. Like a lot of other races before, right. You know, Bethany, if you're talking about Summer Lee, you're talking about Sarah Namorado, these like new, younger, very progressive Democrats, Mick Pappas, they all happened at certain districts within pretty liberal areas of the county. Bethany was able to win with every county vote during a Democratic primary. And that's really, you know, like as we're watching some big hits here on the wrestling match, it really was, to be honest, I was shocked when it happened. I was like, whoa. And so it was.
I don't know about your campaign, but this match is a pure sixer. And you can see Mr. Wonderful there. You know he's Mr. Wonderful because he has it on his ass.
and you know, really, like, you know, Bethany and some other candidates handed their ass to them as well in terms of that. You know, Bethany, I guess what I'm curious about is, like, are we gonna see that continue? Are we seeing that continue, I guess, already since your election?
Yeah, I definitely think it really just hasn't stopped, you know? And so, you know, it's weird that you mentioned how, you know, people had done this before me. Candidates had taken on the Democratic establishment, had taken on these big names in politics, you know, preaching a new school, right? That's what the message was, and they won. Right. And so I think it was a test for us too. Like, we did want to know, we've done this, we've organized on, you know, a smaller scale in districts throughout the county, but Right. Can we do this at the county level? And so what I plan, at least, for the next year and the few years after that, the plan is really to actually focus it more on a more micro level and start looking at school boards and boards of commissioners and town councils, and looking at these even hyper local races and saying, hey, we've done it in state rep districts, we've done it in magisterial district judge districts, we've done it in city council and county council districts. Now we've done it countywide. Can we also do it in municipalities at the local level all over the county? And so that's really what the plan is now, is to say, this is a new wave. This is a new world of politics, and it doesn't need to be the way it was for so long anymore, because that way didn't work for anyone.
Are there any obvious targets there at the municipal or local level who are professional wrestlers?
None that I know of, and that's actually a disappointment, because I actually have had some great ideas for, like, a wrestling tournament to raise money for campaigns. Unfortunately, my former opponent was not down for the idea, so I'm still regretting that to this day. But at least we can sit here and watch a real live wrestling match and talk about how we are going to pin to the mat other non-progressive candidates throughout the county who need somebody to take them down and bring in the new world of politics in Allegheny County.
Right.
And like, I have a bell and I can announce.
Bring it out.
I'm there for you.
Yeah. You know, 2021 is going to be really interesting. Obviously, the election coming up is purely focused on really on the presidency and some other, you know, some other maybe state house races. But for the most part, I think if people are really interested in, you know, Allegheny County politics, the most interesting stuff is kind of the off-year races, like Bethany's race in the odd years, basically, and in the Democratic primary. That's where the matches are. That's where the real wrestling matches are during those Democratic primaries, and progressives have been extremely successful in those specific instances so far. And it's going to be really interesting to see, you know, how that continues out in terms of
it's the sleeper hold, Ryan.
That's right.
It's wrestling's most dangerous move.
That's what Bethany's trying to do right now to county council, is she's trying to put it in that sleeper hold. But she needs some more teammates, I think, because she's a little outnumbered right now. Is that right?
That's right. Please, I need somebody on my tag team, right? I'm so lucky that I have Councilwoman Bennett. You know, she's really been my ride or die. We ran together, we got elected together, and now we govern together. Right. I'm really lucky, you know, Councilwoman Prizio, you know, but three of us on a body of 15. It is an awesome start. It's a great start, and we're getting some fantastic legislation introduced, and at the very least, moving the Overton window and changing the conversation. County Council has never had to take a stand on the issues, ever. No. You know, and so it's interesting to see how much a body can change by just electing two or three people. But imagine if we had 8, 9, or 10. Imagine if we had a majority of progressives, a majority of just folks in general who want to legislate, who are sick of just doing proclamations week after week and doing motions of council week after week and just nothing of substance, you know?
Are you worried that in some of these other areas, like let's take county council, like 15 body thing, I think there's 12 Democrats and what, 3 Republicans, and are you worried, because obviously you're going to have to either flip the Republican seats or challenge the Democrats in those certain areas, are you worried that like an area like the Mon Valley or the Allikiski Valley, like are progressives going to be able to compete there?
Yeah, definitely. That's actually an awesome question. We are going to flip a seat from red to blue next year. That I am confident of. There is one Republican seat that is up. There's an awesome candidate in the race, thinking about getting in the race now. And so I'm confident that we flip that District 1 county council seat next year. You can hear me say it here today, because that's happening next year. So that's one flip. What?
I said you're calling your shot.
I am, yeah, because, you know, I think that one of the things about the old school political dynamic is they always, like, worked in silence, right? They were always behind this cloak, not transparent, not out in the open, and that's one of the things I want to change. Like, I'm not going to be, like, conniving behind the scenes to get rid of you. I'm going to let you know, hey, we're coming for you. You're not doing your job. That's what we just saw there.
I don't want to interrupt, but what just happened to Bruno Sammartino there, that's the sort of thing that, even though that's a new school wrestler doing it, Cowboy Bob Orton walked right up behind him and hit him with that chair. That's what you're talking about, Councilwoman. That's wrong.
That's exactly what it is, you know?
That's how you win.
That is exactly how you win. You know, and we could sit here and say, oh, we got a couple seats and that's enough. Or, oh, we got them to vote on a couple things and that's enough. But that's never going to be enough until we have legislation in this county that protects every person that lives here. Until we have legislation in this county that increases access for everyone to public transportation and health protections in the workplace and so many other forms of preventing discrimination. Until we have legislation that does all of these things for everyone, you know, our work is not going to be done. And so I really have come to realize over especially the last, 9 months now I've been on council, I mean, long enough to have a baby, right? And so I've been there long enough now that I've realized that you can only go so far without having folks who are there willing to do the work that it takes for a countywide legislative body. And so many people aren't interested, and they're not even about compromise. It's just, no, you want to legislate something? Oh, well, I don't think that's under our purview. That's not our job. That is literally what our job is.
Right. I think what you're saying is that this is the modern realities of politics that a lot of people don't understand. A lot of people want to believe that either they believe a totally idealistic vision or they totally believe a totally pessimistic vision, right? Where it's like they don't do anything. They're dumb, they're useless. Those people totally check out and never participate. That's their right as Americans, obviously. But then there's the other side that are totally idealistic, and they're like, oh, they'll just work together and do it. That's not how politics works. You have to build coalitions. You have to build tag teams. You have to build these kind of things to actually get things passed. And right now, like you're saying, you know, as I've observed as a political writer, is that you ran into a little bit of a wall, right? With council, and like you've introduced some bills and they're not moving forward, and you know the only reality of that is that you can try to persuade some of these people, but what's their motivation to do so except to get kicked out of office, right?
Exactly. And so at the very least, what we've created is, you know, oppo research on them for whenever they're up again. And I do think that you're going to start seeing progressive challengers to candidates in these areas that formerly You never thought it could happen. And I think that that's why my race was so important, was because we saw that it could be done on a county scale, right? And so now that we've seen it happen at the county level, there's areas, like regions, that I won, but it was close. There's regions where I lost, right? And so that's why my race was so important, because it got us that data set, you know?
Oh, like a map. It's a perfect map of where progressives can win. And what a lot of people need to understand, and I'm trying to hammer this to a lot of people, is that the areas where progressives can win in Allegheny County are kind of upper scale suburbs.
Yes.
That's where you won. That's where you won, but you didn't win like in the Mon Valley, for example, you know? And this is the new progressive coalition that people really need to understand is forming. I think this, I think some people on the left, and maybe even like Bernie supporters on the left, and you know, definitely I know that you endorse Bernie, and I've definitely written about Bernie in a positive light and all these things, but a lot of his supporters believe that there was this almost like lower class or rural urban, you know, coalition. And that would be great and ideal. But at the same time, the votes just aren't shaking out that way, you know?
I think that that is why, when we talk about running candidates in these local municipal races, why that's so important, because a lot of folks really just don't turn out to vote in these areas that you're talking about, right? And I will never, ever, ever shame somebody who doesn't vote, because when there's not a candidate on your ballot that sounds like they're going to do anything for you, why would you come out to vote? Why would you go out of your way to cast the vote when there's nobody on the ballot that speaks to what you need? Because right. At the end of the day, anybody can say whatever they want about voting, but we all vote selfishly, right? We vote for what's going to help us, what's going to make our lives better. So if there's never been a candidate on the ballot for you that's going to make your life any better, why would you vote for them? So when we start putting candidates in these local municipal races where we can be hyper focused on outreach to voters, where a couple hundred dollars can fund an entire campaign,
with a couple hundred votes.
A couple hundred votes. I mean, that is the reality. And so whenever we start getting those people into office, the people who are speaking to the progressive changes that are needed, that's when I think the community will start to see, like, oh, this person, these type of people, right? Progressives, these people who speak about these values are gonna make my life better. So maybe I should start voting. Maybe I should vote for them. Maybe I should look into this and find more people like them who also wanna make my life better.
Right. And that's, and like what you're describing is really that difference between the new school that's emerging in Allegheny County versus the old school, which was more just that kind of like, bring out your ward members, kind of like bring out our club kind of, you know, mindset. Whoever can get the most people on the clubs that are already established can, you know, will basically hold the seat. And it becomes hard to even distinguish between candidates, between elected officials, where their stances are, what they want to do, what their vision is for the area. And that's the one thing that as a political writer and as a progressive political writer is that let's talk about visions for the area. Let's talk about things that we need to do, that we want to make people's lives different. And I think that really is kind of the fight that we're still having in a lot of these local races in Allegheny County. And I hope that, you know, more people will start paying attention.
Well, one point I wanted to make was, again, going back to the injustice of this particular match. One thing I know from being a professional wrestling historian, this match resulted in Bruno Sammartino and Mr. Wonderful walking directly to professional wrestling's governing body for a ruling on that unfortunate chair incident outside the ring. And I know that Councilwoman Hallam, you've been involved in an instrumental party in one of our own local governing bodies, the Board of Elections here in Allegheny County. Talk a little bit about what's going on with the recruitment of new poll workers and getting new people involved where, you know, I hate to do the old school, new school thing, but there's a lot of senior citizens been spending a lot of time for a lot of decades in that position at our polls. That's changing, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Actually, the Board of Elections is, I mean, there's no contest. It's my favorite part of my job. I think that everything comes down to making sure that elections are secure, making sure that you can vote safely, making sure that obstacles to voting are removed. And so everything that we talk about issues wise ties into that. If you don't have safe, secure, and accessible elections, then none of the work that we're trying to do anywhere will ever matter, because anybody can hack an election or anyone can rig the vote. And so I think that's why it's so important to me. But regards to poll workers, we had a blitz, right? So we spent the past 3-4 weeks, and when I say we, I mean elected officials, I mean grassroots groups, I mean not the county, not the elections division, not on behalf of the Board of Elections, but regular people who realize how important this is, have had a blitz all over the country for poll workers. There's been a big target here in Pennsylvania and definitely in Allegheny County, because as you said, the people who work the polls are like grandparents and great grandparents, and you know, are elderly, and they've been doing it for 50 years.
We have a lot of polls too. There's a ton of polls in Pennsylvania. There's so many polling places.
And in Allegheny County, right? I mean, why in the hell do we have 1,323 precincts in Allegheny County?
Like, so you can walk. So you can walk to your polling place. It's good. I'm pro more polling places.
I am cool with the amount of polling locations, right? We have about 900 polling locations. Right. We don't need more than 900 voting precincts.
That's fair.
So that's more what I feel like, is that, yeah, you should be able to walk to your poll. Like, I wish we had 5,000 polling locations and literally you walk to the end of your street. Everyone literally walked to the end of their street and voted. But luckily, we have mail-in voting now, and you can vote from your couch without even having to walk to the end of your
street. Right.
But yeah, it's the way that the way that our county is we're so fragmented when we talk about government. Right. You know, we're so fragmented when we talk about Pennsylvania as a commonwealth, and we're the only second class county in the entire commonwealth. And so, you know, there's things about Allegheny County that are so unique and different than anywhere else that you'll see in the country. One is former tag team partner wrestlers serving on county council together. But another thing is the fact that because we have 1,323 precincts and because we have 900 polling locations, there is always going to be a need for poll workers. Always. You're never, ever going to have an election ever where, oh no, we're cool, like don't sign up. Because you always need a reserve. You always need a backup. We always end up with county employees who are having to work the polls because we're not going to reach the 6,600. That's the number that we need to staff all 1,323 precincts in Allegheny County. And so what we've been doing is just trying to make it sexy for younger people, right? And so I know I made a couple like gifts, like trying to get people involved to vote. If I knew how to TikTok, I probably would have been on there getting people to sign up to be poll workers. I know some folks were, so that's awesome.
Also, it's like $200 this year, right?
$200.
$200.
That's incredibly sexy.
Yeah. And that's what I'm saying, is we've for so long used this language, volunteer to be a poll worker. So I think that that's one of the reasons that we've always seen like more of an elderly crowd, because they just want to serve. They don't care about the money. They're not in it for the clout. They literally just want to serve.
Yeah.
And so that's why I've been trying to take the language away from volunteer to be a poll worker and instead get paid to be a poll worker.
Right.
Paid to help democracy.
Yeah.
What a racket. Wow.
Go sign up to be a poll worker and sign up to mail and vote, or don't, or just get registered.
Get registered. In Pennsylvania, you have until seven days prior to the election to request your mail-in ballot, and you have 15 days prior to the election to register to vote. So that's October 19th and October 27th. Those are the two dates that you need to remember. October 19th to register to vote, October 27th, deadline to request your mail-in ballot. So you know what? You just finished watching this awesome show. Why don't you just go and do it now?
Do it now.
And vote. And you know, if you're going to mail in vote, do that right now too, because that's going to help the county count votes early. I can't stress that enough. If you're going to mail in vote, just do it. Request your ballot. It should be sent sometime next week, I believe, is like when they're going to start sending them out. Get it, turn it back in right away. Just do it right away. Don't wait. Do it right away.
Exactly.
Well, thank you very much. Our special guest today, Councilwoman Bethany Hallam, and as always, Ryan Dito, professional pundit and journalist, actual journalist. Thanks so much for taking part today. Folks, tune in again next time for big time political wrestling. And now back to the third round. And thank you. Hey, people. it's time for So These Pandemics, brought to you by beer. And now, right on into So These Pandemics.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the program. We're going to be talking about drinking, which is one of my favorite topics, and kind of how to stay healthy and safe during the pandemic and this kind of ongoing changes that we've had throughout the state in terms of drinking in bars and drinking outside of bars and whatnot. I was actually in Erie just a couple of weeks ago, drinking at some establishments up there in downtown Erie, which is super cool because it has a, you know, the area has one of the only like open container laws in the state, which was cool. But anyway, so I want to introduce Brianna Adams. She's the Director of Environmental Health Services at the Erie County Department of Health. Hello there.
Hi, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I'm well.
Okay. Well, yeah, in your expertise, because this is obviously your field, what can you tell us about what people should be doing to ensure the kind of correct coronavirus, protocols when going to bars?
Sure. So I think one of the most important things is people just realizing and knowing how it spreads, right? So coronavirus is being spread by those respiratory droplets. You're either getting a little bit over a longer period of time, or you could get a lot in a short period of time. And so taking a lot of personal precautions and limiting your exposure time is the best recommendation that we would have.
So don't stay too long, basically.
Pretty much, yeah. So the targeted mitigation orders are in effect right now from the Secretary of Health, Rachel Levine, and Governor Wolf's office. And so I think that, you know, at first people were very concerned, you know, like, oh, it's going to get me if I don't have food on my table. But what it really is that, again, just limiting that type of exposure, trying to say, you know, yes, it is okay for you to go and have a drink with a friend or a meal with a friend. But we don't need everybody like running up to the bar and hugging each other and hanging out for all night long at this point of time.
So what if you own a bar? Like, what's the best way to help, you know, customers follow those kind of, you know, recommendations?
So I think if you own a bar or a restaurant that you're the one setting the example, right? So in the very beginning stages of this, and I was actually off from March to May. So I came back like right in the middle, right as we were heading towards this. And I think that by being the example and setting that tone for your own restaurant or bar is just keeps the ball rolling for your patrons. And, you know, it shows them that you respect their health, that hopefully they are respecting you and your staff and your establishment. Because part of it is thinking again about how it spreads, but then that contact tracing part that we've heard so much about. If you are a patron and you're at your favorite bar and you're sitting at your bar for 2 hours or 3 hours or five or however long, that bartender isn't far enough away from you that then they're considered a contact. And the people that they work with are considered contacts. And so then that bar has to close anyway.
Right.
So I know it's
throughout the whole thing, basically.
Right. So I know that it's still not favorable and we still all want those nights out or extended periods of time. But I think that kind of trying to meet in the middle and you know, go out, but be respectful of the orders that are in place and the staff that are trying to keep them in place while still working to support themselves and their families is the best middle ground for everybody.
Right. So, you know, I do a lot of social media reporting and, you know, those kind of things. And something that with this kind of media everywhere, let's do some myth busting, right? So what are some, you know, myths that you've seen or kind of things out there that people are recommending that aren't a good idea, basically? For, you know, bars and restaurants to do.
I think just the biggest thing was right when the targeted mitigation orders came out, and it was like, well, if I have a French fry on my table, then I can't get Corona. And that I don't think that that was the point of that. I don't work for the governor's office and I can't really speak to that, but I think the more science behind it is just those like prolonged time that you would be spending with someone if you, outside of eating a meal. Other myths, I know I've seen a lot of things about masks and, you know, like, oh, how is this supposed to protect me? But it really, they really, really do. And if you're worried, you know, there are a few of our coworkers here, they, when they buy a new mask, they do a candle test and they, you know, try to blow through it if you can blow a candle out or not. Knowing those types of things that protect yourself and others, I think is just the most helpful that that people can be.
Right. So like wear your mask is basically.
Wear your mask, yes. Oh, but one myth, right. And one of the biggest complaints that we get, so right now we're at like over 3,000 complaints, and normally we're probably under 1,000 for the year of restaurants and different places. And so a large number of those complaints have been COVID related. And one of the biggest ones is that maybe people in the kitchen aren't wearing masks. And so just to clarify that, they don't have to if it's going to put them at risk for injuring themselves. So say that, you know, we're going out and ordering pizza logs, which is like my favorite bar food. but then someone's standing over a fryer, they don't want to, you know, if they're going to look, not be able to look down and could burn themselves, then they don't have to have a mask on at that point.
Okay.
Now there's other precautions. Obviously you don't want five people in that kitchen all not wearing a mask. They could wear, you know, the plastic face shield as a level of protection. And then when they're, you know, away from that fry line or away from the cutting board, then a mask would be required at that point.
That kind of nuance that like is there. It's not like, you know, you have to wear it at every waking second, basically, but there are moments when you might be able, you know, to take it off, but you want to put it back on, basically, at a lot of times.
Right, absolutely. So those are like the exceptions, is if it's going to cause you harm or hurt yourself further than, you know, not wearing it at that point. But like I said, maybe a face shield for some degree of protection then.
Okay, what are pizza logs? Sorry, I have no
idea. Pizza logs?
Get with it. Okay, you don't know, do you know?
Yeah, I don't know.
I've never heard of these before.
You got to watch a Pens game or a Steelers game. They always advertise them.
Absolutely.
I'm still learning so much. I'm from California originally, so I've been here like 5 years. I'm still learning, you know.
So fired.
Might be Western Pennsylvania. I don't know. It's like a... just a freezer to fryer food with sauce and cheese and pepperoni in it, and like kind of like a wonton wrapper.
Oh, okay, that sounds really good.
But I mean, then you come to Erie and we have like pepperoni balls, which I guess are an Erie thing. Yeah. And all kinds of great foods here.
That's awesome. Okay, so you know, we talk about all these different I guess regulations and rules and stuff like that. What like resources are available to owners, employees, and everyone in the restaurant industry that you guys offer, I guess?
Sure. So I think that there's like signage available through the Pennsylvania State Department of Health, through the CDC, but also each state, and I believe even nationally, there are like restaurant and lodging associations. And so they have been putting out a lot of great messaging, more like a promise, like, as a restaurant owner, my promise to you is that I'm going to take these precautions to keep you safe, right? Some extra cleaning, taking care of my staff, but then what, you know, to build the consumer confidence within their restaurant, but then also as someone going to the bar or restaurant, what are you going to promise to them back? So I think that, early on, but even as we continue, just letting those restaurant owners, letting those bar owners set their expectation and say like, hey, this is all the extra things that we're doing to stay open, to be here for you. And this is why we're doing it. And that really sets the tone for the patrons as well.
Right. And that like sets that kind of like positive, you know, reinforcing relationship that like during this pandemic we probably really need. Right.
Ryan, can I ask our final probing question?
Please. Yeah, please.
And I know you've had time to consider this, Brianna. If you had to pick a song, and you have to pick a song, that would describe for you 2020 and 2020 and the election, what would that song be?
So I know you had warned me, but I actually forgot about this question until right before I logged on. And so my 2020 song has really been Hey Jude.
Okay.
And, you know, pick a sad song, make it better, right? So I feel like we're kind of singing a sad song these days between all the things that are going on. So that is, without my few days of preparation, that's what came to my head.
Thank you. Thank you. That is my first positive suggestion on this question. Everything else has been bitter and angry.
All so right.
Thank
well,
you. Thank you for that's your health positive and your outlook positive.
Yeah.
All right.
Good. That's good. It's awesome.
Wonderful. Great.
Well, I would thank you both for this exciting segment as we wrap up our first edition of So, These Pandemics. Thanks very much for your time. And Ryan and Brianna, we'll look forward to seeing you down the road again.
All right. Sounds great. Thank you so much.
Great. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Brianna Adams and the Erie County Health Department for your help in today's episode of So, These Pandemics. And thank you to our official Pennsylvania Naked Ballots elected leadership for their kind information on how to dress your ballots. That's all for today's third round, except for our important outro song, the 2020 political song of the week. This week's What You See Is What You Get.